First of all, let me say thanks for the podium. It's the right height. Jeff, thank you for such a kind introduction. And let me tell all of your colleagues, the reason that you and I get along so well is that I like being next to you, and I'm just hoping I end up looking like you. Truth of the matter is, so is Andrea. Let me say, friends, it's great to be here at Membertou. Chief Terry, let me say thank you for welcoming the Liberal Party of Nova Scotia here at Membertou, but more importantly, let me say thank you for working with our government in so many files. An untold story. Minister McClellan mentioned, if you don't mind, I'll call you Jeff, since we're in your neighborhood. Jeff mentioned about the fact that as a government, we've had a number of challenges. He mentioned the Nova Scotia Home for Colored Children, and he also mentioned Boat Harbor. I hate to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, it is at a time in our history when racism was prominent and our forefathers didn't respond the way they should have. I am so proud of the way our government responded to the Nova Scotia Home for Colored Children to right an historic wrong. But I'm equally proud of the work Minister Delory has been doing in Pictou Landing. Very early on in my journey, I'm not even sure I was the Premier, came to meet Chief Terry. I mentioned to him about some challenges that our province were facing, but I also spoke to him about Boat Harbor and how I felt, how wrong it was as we as a province had turned our back on a community. And it was my belief that the only reason that Boat Harbor ever existed was because it was next to an Aboriginal community. And in his mind, he nodded. I felt like I was in a boxing match and no one told me he was a boxer. And we left. Then the pipe broke, incidents were happening, and everyone wanted to pile on to make it a much bigger, controversial issue, including opposition, including members outside of our province. Unbeknownst to many Nova Scotians, it was Chief Terry who called Chief Andrea and said the Premier had mentioned this to me in a conversation that we had, unprovoked, and I believe he's going to do right for your community. And it was from that moment in time when Minister Delory was able to begin a conversation with Pictou Landing to lead us to where an historic event, where we as a government have introduced legislation, putting timelines on a government to solve this issue once and for all. Chief Terry, Chief Terry, I want to thank you for your leadership. I'm looking forward to continuing to work with you, and I'm continuing to wanting to tell you how much we have to learn from you and the success here at Membertou, and I will speak to that as we go forward. I also want to acknowledge the elders here at Membertou, and I want to say to the Mi'kmaq community, on all of us, pass on our sympathies for the loss of Chief Charlie Joe Dennis in a neighboring community of Eskasoni. He was a leader not only in his community, but he was a leader across our province. And it was Pam Eiking representing me there today to celebrate his life. And Pam, thank you. But Chief Terry, pass on to the community of Eskasoni our deepest sympathies on the loss of a great Nova Scotian, Chief Charlie Dennis. You know, my mother said, if you live long enough, you'll see just about anything. And seeing Cecil Clark at a Liberal convention was right up there. Cecil, it's great to have you here. Let me say, first of all, it was great to be a colleague with you in the legislature. We not only was Cecil speaker, as I heard him mention about Kevin, but he was Minister of Energy and the Minister of a number of justice. There's a straitjacket, actually, as you go into the Minister of Justice, that's there for any new minister that Cecil left behind. Because he said for any premier to appoint someone to be justice minister and they accept they deserve to have a straitjacket. So it's hanging on. But Cecil, let me say thank you for the work you've done provincially and the work that you're doing here in CBRM and the partnership that we've been able to build to find some common ground to be able to move the economy of your region forward, the economy of our province forward. And thank you for continuing to step up to represent your community. John, thank you for leading our party. John has taken on the task of helping us rebuild our party. Helping us rebuild our party when we were the third party in the legislature and moving us now to a majority government. His problem was he wasn't smart enough to leave on election night, so now he's here to help us continue to keep us there. So John, thank you for that commitment to the party. And on behalf of all Liberals across Nova Scotia, we are indebted for the hard work that you've shown for us and the entire executive of the Nova Scotia Liberal Party. Let me say these have been challenging times for us as a government. There have been difficult decisions to make. I'm very proud of the men and women who were introduced to you earlier as our caucus. On election night, people focused on the fact that we had a majority government. I've said this time and time again, they should have been focusing on the quality of the men and women who are elected to help us lead this province. I am so very, very fortunate. I believe I've been given the privilege that very few premiers have been given, and that is that I get to pick the cabinet out of a super, super group of Nova Scotians, all capable of representing me. As we embarked on putting a budget together over the last couple of years, but more importantly over the last budget we brought forward, it was a very difficult process. One where as a government we had to make very, very difficult decisions that I must tell you, I believe they were the right decisions. When we made those decisions, I slept well at night. But I can tell you there's one that has kept me up, and it's not one that is easy to deal with. When you have to tell someone they no longer have a job. There's been a lot of talk about policy changes. There's been a lot of talk about the fact that we've made some changes to programs inside of government. But on that night, we told some Nova Scotians they no longer had a job. And that is not an easy decision to make. Those men and women who work for the provincial government go to work every day just like you and I, trying to do the best they can. They have families like you and I. They go home to their kitchen table, hoping to have a discussion about what's up for tomorrow. I didn't feel great, I must tell you, leading up to budget day and days after, realizing that men and women had gone home to have a very different discussion that night. But in my heart, I believe we as a province had to change on what we were doing. We could no longer accept, just because we've been doing it that way for 30 years, that we have to continue to do it. They are very, very difficult conversations to have with Nova Scotians, who've been used to relying on certain programs, certain individuals, certain departments. If we want to continue to do the things the way we've always done them, then we'll continue to be the worst performing economy in Canada, and we'll continue to see young children, our children, leave this province for other opportunities. That's not good enough. I didn't seek to be the premier of this province to hold the office or for the power. I sought to be the premier of this province because I want to make a difference. And we can make a difference if we're prepared to stand together. Some of you may feel like you've seen this show before. And I don't blame you. But I ask you to continue to give us your support as we embark on transforming this province. When we made decisions about cuts in our government, we made decisions about what services we were prepared to provide. We didn't just go ahead and cut 10% off the top of the civil service, as so many people were telling us to do. Well, we looked at what are the services we are delivering and the programs we're delivering to Nova Scotians, and what are the ones we should be doing and what are the ones we shouldn't be doing. And when we landed on something we shouldn't be doing, we removed it from our responsibility. We as a government, as a province, have a responsibility to ensure that we provide top quality education, we provide top quality health care, that we ensure the most vulnerable citizens in our community are cared for and looked after, and that we allow the private sector to drive economic opportunities. I am so proud of the fact that even in these very difficult times, even in these very difficult times, the men and women in the Liberal caucus stood shoulder to shoulder and said, the next generation of young Nova Scotians will not have to pay our bill. We will invest in public education today, tomorrow, and as long as we are a government. And we did so not just by saying we're going to reverse the cuts that had taken place under the former government and throw more money at the issue. We did so by looking at where are the opportunities, what are the changes that are taking place in public education, what are the new opportunities to invest in. We've listened to teachers who have said our curriculum is a mile wide and an inch thick. Well, we're about to tell you in the coming weeks, the minister will tell you that we're about to make it an inch wide and a mile thick on the basic fundamentals of literacy and numeracy and supporting classroom teachers to ensure that every child in this province has an opportunity to fully get the basics of education and a platform to launch his or her passion in whichever direction it wants to take them. Some of you may have heard of the Graduate Retention Rebate Program. I hear the moaning from the front row. It was a program that provided a rebate to graduates in this province who had been given the good fortune of finding a job. And I want to tell you, for those that had been receiving it, I understand the benefit. That is trying to provide opportunity for a broader number of young people, was it the best place for us to invest that money? And it wasn't. And we had to have a conversation with Nova Scotians about it. But we didn't just cancel the program to recoup the money. We put the money back in a program called Graduate to Opportunity, where we actually reach out to employers, not the graduate, we reach to the employers, and we encourage employers across this province to provide an opportunity for that graduate, whether it's community college or university, to give them their first job here at home. And we'll help them with the fiscal challenges associated with hiring that student. But you know what? Young people aren't leaving here because of the Graduate Retention Rebate Program. They're leaving here because they don't have a job. And through this program, we will provide more opportunity for young Nova Scotians under the leadership of Minister Regan. We'll provide more Nova Scotian children an opportunity to find that job here at home. And we'll do so by working in partnership with the private sector. It is not the government that will drive economic growth and job creation in Nova Scotia. We have a role to play, but it will be the private sector that drives that opportunity. You heard Chief Paul talk about that earlier. I want to tell you, under the leadership of Minister Bernard, there's been a lot of challenges facing vulnerable Nova Scotians. She's worked extremely hard over the last 18 months to build partnership with community. We have work to do, we know that, she knows that. But she's done a tremendous job to begin to build a launching pad to where we make sure that vulnerable Nova Scotians realize they have a friend in the government. Someone who is not working there to give them a handout, but to give them a hand up. Someone there to give them the skills to be able to change the direction of their lives. And that journey is not always easy. It sounds simple. A lot of Nova Scotians look down, quite frankly, on our fellow citizens who are in income assistance. There are people who believe they do it by choice. No one that I know, who I've had the privilege to represent in the last 10 years, has ever gone income assistance by choice. No one. They've done so. It's happened because of circumstance. And let me tell you, each of us should look at the person sitting next to us and say how fortunate and blessed we are to be able to sit next to you, but recognize it could be us. Not everyone is blessed to have a loving family around them. Not everyone is blessed to have a supporting network around them to ensure them on the most vulnerable days that they can be picked up and allowed to move forward. And for those Nova Scotians who are left by themselves or alone, it is the Department of Community Services who they need to turn to. And they don't want to turn to one that is going to keep them in that position. They want to turn to a minister and a department that will help them move forward. And I am so proud of the work that is taking place in that department. Let me tell you, as all of that has been happening and the challenges that we have been facing, with all of the tough decisions that we've been making, we've been able to partner with so many good people to have great things happening. I can't tell you how proud I am the fact that Donkin Mine is soon to begin moving production. That didn't happen by accident. Minister McClellan, Minister Churchill, worked extremely hard with the Klein Group to ensure that we get back into production. How does it make sense that we're not burning our own coal in this province? Whether we like it or not, coal is king when it comes to generating power. And why doesn't it make sense that we can do it here? But it's not the government's role to do it. Let's embrace the private sector to let that happen. And that's exactly what happened. They believed in this province. They believed in investing in this province. They invest globally, and they chose Nova Scotia. Vulcan Resources, an American company, probably the largest aggregate company in the world, chose Guysborough to invest its money to put a mine there. Lloyd hasn't stopped smiling since he heard that news. I want to tell you, Lloyd is one of those people who continue to drive economic development in Guysborough across our province, and as a municipal leader now in the provincial government, continues to push us to look for economic opportunities and job creation. And Lloyd continue to do what's been happening in Guysborough County and speaking out to ensure that we recognize the rural economy is built on our resources. In Richmond County with Bear Head and Goldborough, also in Guysborough County, we're seeing foreign investment come into this province, people who are believing in our province and seeing an optimistic future for Nova Scotia. Victor Chu from China put a $50 million equity fund on the table for the people of this province. No other Canadian province can say that. Why? Because he saw the opportunities. He saw the fact that we were moving forward as a province, and he understood for his investment there would be a return and an opportunity not just in this province, but an opportunity to launch from this province across Canada into Europe. They weren't comparing us to Toronto. Victor was looking to us next to our proximity to New York and London. We need to celebrate our location, we need to celebrate our heritage, and we need to prepare to maximize its true value. But I want to go back to Chief Terry. First of all, I'm so proud to be able to partner with you in building that, I want to call it a hockey rink because I'm a hockey guy. The provincial government has partnered with Membertou to build that arena next door, just, and it's on CBRM land, just off Membertou's land. And Chief, I want to tell you how proud we are to be joining that. But I also want to tell you, and I want to tell all members of this hall tonight, Membertou is an example of how we as a province can move forward. Membertou has moved forward on two ways. First of all, it ensured that the community of Membertou was safe and secure and stable. And then it built partnerships. It moved out beyond the community of Membertou to build economic partnerships, social partnerships, to make sure that they were not only a community of a boundary, but a community of a broader community. It's what we need to do. Too often, is in our own communities, our own province, quite frankly, our own region, our own country. We're afraid to open our boundaries. We're afraid to build those relationships that are required to move this province forward. If we are to be successful, if we will ever move ourselves forward from being the worst performing economy in Canada, we need to be prepared to shape the change instead of letting the change shape us. We need to be prepared to step out and say, we deserve to play on this field just like everyone else. We need to be prepared to step out and say, we have the skills, we have the intelligence, we have all the things required to build an economy to provide opportunities right here at home. Membertou did that. We can do that in the greater community. So I want to say to you, we have challenging times still ahead of us. We came to power. We were on the back end of a 3-year labor deal. 2.5% and 3% pay raises for all public sector. And I'm not suggesting anyone doesn't deserve it. But it's $700 million embedded in the cost of doing business for the government of Nova Scotia. Let me say that to you again. $700 million. That's a lot of money. If we had kept pace with the growth in our economy, if we had just provided wages that reflected the growth in our economy, we as a government would have today an additional $200 million in our treasury. So instead of having a $100 million deficit, we would be sitting at a $100 million surplus. You and I, and God knows the people outside, and other Nova Scotians, would have a very different conversation. We wouldn't be talking about what do we have to cut, or what do we have to do away with. We would start dreaming about the possibilities. And I look for a day when I can start dreaming about the possibilities. I look forward to the day when I can start hugging and kissing babies again. That was Minister Churchill with the chuckle at the end, because he's heard me say, you kiss the babies and I'll kiss the mothers. I'm looking forward to the day when we can have those choices. And I'm going to tell you, this is where we failed across all political lines in this province. We have failed Nova Scotians by not willing to make very difficult decisions for the right reasons. We need to get to a point where we have a surplus in this province, not because we want to say we flayed the deficit, so we can make choices. So when we see an economic opportunity, we can invest in it. So when we see a new program in education that we can put in a classroom, we want to be able to invest. Canada. When we used to dream big, we used to have national programs. The last national, true national program we had as a country, in my view, was the Health Accord of 2004. And it was only made possible because we had a federal surplus. It meant they had a choice. It meant they could build a country, one that understood the differences of the regions, one that provided a program that united us as a country. We haven't had that opportunity since then. We've run deficit after deficit. And I want to tell you, as a province, we had a moment in time where we had surpluses, but we outstripped the growth in the surplus by spending. And we have a legacy of programs that we're going through now to try to figure out, should we be doing them or not? Because I want to be able to have a conversation about building a provincial daycare program. I want to have the opportunity. I want to be able to have a conversation about what are the possibilities for us as a province. And there are many. But in order for us to have that conversation, we need to be able to do this tough work now. And I know, as members of our party, and as people who've knocked on doors and have convinced friends to vote for us, you carry that burden as well. Your friends aren't calling me. They're sending me an email periodically. They're calling you. And they're saying, hey, you told me to vote for this guy, and he's not what you told me. And I know that's not easy. I know that's not easy. I do want to say thank you, though, for staying true and committed to the party and to us. I also want to tell you, this battle is not just to say we have a surplus. This battle is about having a conversation with Nova Scotians about what's possible. That's a much different conversation. And here's the good news. Minister Whelan is doing such a great job. We're very optimistic as we progress that we will see that day soon. Not that we have to stop making tough decisions, but that we will be able to have a conversation with Nova Scotians about what is possible. I ask you to continue to ask yourself, and for some of you I know why you're in this party. Your fathers, your mothers, your family members. Some of you have joined this party because you believe in that it represents who you are. Some of you have joined it for all kinds of reasons. I'm sure some of you are in this room tonight because of the men and women who are sitting in front of us and those that are running for office in the upcoming by-elections. But ask yourself the fundamental question of when you joined it, what was the real reason for that? And have we strayed so far from that point? And I would say to you, no. I was going to tell Cecil that I used to tell my mother I was fiscally conservative. And she said that doesn't count when you're poor. Well, as many of you know, being one of 17, I had good training to get a broke province. But let me be clear to you, as party members, I have not lost the way of why I'm a liberal. I am fiscally conservative. I do believe we need to be able to pay our way. I do believe, though, that the next generation shouldn't have to pay for my freight. But I also believe in building a very dynamic province. And we can only do that when we get our fiscal house in order. We can invest in the social and economic things, opportunities that are before us. We can continue to develop the Port of Sydney. We can continue to work with those in Inverness, continue to make sure that the new owners of Celtic have an opportunity to continue to build this world-class tourism destination that we have. We can continue to invest in classrooms across Cape Breton Island like we have in Inverness and Glace Bay when it comes to the skilled trades program. We could continue to see where are the community investments that we need to make that make a difference for Nova Scotia families, make a difference for families here. But in order for us to get to that day, we need you to continue to be patient, continue to work with us, continue to make sure that we give Nova Scotians the government that they want. I can tell you there are two other people in this province that want the job I have, and there are a lot of other people in this province who want the jobs that the ministers and members of the government caucus want. But there are no other group of men and women in this province who are prepared to make the very difficult decisions that will help change the structure of this government, of the government of Nova Scotia, and there are no other group of men and women that are prepared to move this province forward in an optimistic way, to grab a hold of the opportunities that are before us, with the main focus being the men and women who live in this province, and that is you and Nova Scotians. Thank you for allowing us to be here.